This is Boston, best known for its colleges, Fenway Park, and the Boston Marathon. Boston houses over 600,000 people, but this number does not account for everything else living in the city. While urban skyscrapers and a vast suburban landscape dominate the skyline, forests, parks, and natural areas comprise their own valuable ecosystems. However, places to explore nature are limited in the city. Rows and rows of buildings obstruct opportunities for nature to thrive. The cost of an urban lifestyle is clear: less access to green space. While cities make up only 2% of the Earth's surface, they house more than half of the world's population. Cities are very important to the global economy, as they generate over 80% of the world's gross domestic product. Because cities house so many people, they create job opportunities, attract investments, and much more. While cities are important, they are also harmful to the environment. Cities produce over 70% of global CO2 emissions, one of the biggest contributors to climate change, which causes detrimental environmental impacts like urban heat islands, higher temperatures, poor air and water quality, storms, flooding, and more. Climate change affects everyone, not just environmentally, but physically and mentally as well. Lack of green spaces in cities exacerbates these effects. These issues are prevalent in most urban environments, including the city of Boston. However, throughout the city, there are natural havens that strengthen the land and surrounding neighborhoods. These green spaces benefit communities' health and provide a place for people to connect with the natural world and each other. The integration of nature into urban areas not only has positive environmental impacts, but can also strengthen community and lead to a better mental well-being. Activists all around the city are working hard to maintain and restore its green spaces for a happier and healthier Boston. In addition to improving the quality of life, Boston citizens are trying to fight the climate crisis with more greenery. Trees absorb carbon dioxide and protect from natural disasters, particularly flooding, a frequent problem in Boston. According to the UN, by the year 2050, over two-thirds of the human population will live in cities. To maintain societal, personal, and climate wellness, urban wilds are a must. Making these spaces available to city dwellers is essential to ensure the well-being of the planet and that everyone has access to nature, no matter where they live. As Boston residents continue on this journey to restore greenery to urban areas, cities like Singapore, Vienna, and Oslo have already made progress on this goal. For example, in Singapore, about 47% of the city consists of green space, in Vienna the number is 50%, and Oslo has 68% of its city dedicated to nature. However, just 4% of Boston's 60,000 acres are green space. Boston's issue with decreasing green spaces overlaps with other kinds of social inequities, inspiring a need for environmental justice. Boston is currently facing an incredible lack of affordable housing. The 2022 Greater Boston Housing Report Card graded Boston as failing in almost every category, including housing accessibility, equity, and availability. Not only is housing unaffordable, but low-income residents are the first to face consequences of various public health crises. Black and brown citizens were most affected by the lack of preparedness during the early months of the COVID-19 pandemic, simultaneously at the highest risk of exposure and the last of communities to receive vaccines. When it comes to climate preparedness, the pattern is no different. Unprecedented climate-related flooding levels have damaged the homes of new residents and residents who have inhabited their property for generations, along with ramping up insurance costs. East Boston, which is experiencing the worst effects, is historically inhabited by working-class immigrants. Here, the effects of flooding are exacerbated by infrastructure built to benefit wealthier white citizens of the northern suburbs.
Dale, these are neighborhoods that are over 60% people of color, and so that they are neighborhoods that have historically, folks of color have been negatively impacted by various climate crises, and so that is fundamentally the other issue.
Since the city's founding in 1630, it has grown significantly. Originally called Shama by the Native American population, this small piece of land, less than 800 acres, featured an isthmus keeping it attached to the mainland, which submerged during high tides. The city was forced to expand certain sections of land to accommodate growing populations. This expansion of land area was driven by four main justifications. The first was an increased quality of harbors. Second was the burying of wastewater and pollution in an effort to improve public health. The third was improved public parks, and the fourth justification was improved railroads. Expansion occurred in combination with the flattening of the area. The field of landscape architecture originated due to health-related concerns that arose parallel with the population growth in cities.
The beginning of the field of landscape architecture historically in the 1800s was because people were getting sick. There was, you know, this new development of these tight cities, high density. Everything built in the 1800s was completely cleared, so nature went away and people were put in very close quarters. And there were outbreaks of like cholera and yellow fever and tuberculosis. And all of those things have to do with too much density and not enough nature. So the whole movement of this separate landscape architecture came out of illness, human illness.
The health of nature is one of the biggest factors influencing human health. In modern times, the consequences of climate change do not affect everyone equally. Generally, people of color are affected first and most. While it began with the best intentions, Boston's expansion led to greater pollution in the modern day, as this unnatural foundation supporting the city leads to chemical runoff and extreme flooding.
There's very high flooding. There's because the water has to go somewhere. It's also, there's a lot more pollution, polluted runoff, because soil takes up polluted, filters polluted runoff. There's more pollution, air pollution as well, because plants take out particulates and air pollution from the air. If you don't have enough nature, the heat effect goes up. And also climate change, because soil and plants sequester carbon.
The Southwest Boston Community Development Corporation is an organization dedicated to protecting and improving the conditions and assets of the neighborhoods of Boston. Board member Pat Alvarez spoke on how the toxic chemical runoff caused by the city's industries may affect local ecosystems.
So we have a river that runs through our neighborhood. It starts as a little trickle in Foxborough and comes all the way north, runs through Hyde Park, through Dorchester, all the way through Mattapan and Dorchester, all the way to Boston Harbor. It's been filled with chemicals, PCBs, from years of industry in the past. It's just recently been designated as a Superfund site, and the EPA is now beginning the process of figuring out how they're going to clean it up. So this is very exciting, because right now it's dangerous to eat the fish in the river. You can't really put your feet in the river without getting full of chemicals. So we're hoping that eventually it will be a beautiful river where people can canoe, where they can kayak, where they can fish along the river.
The situation is a result of both economic and environmental injustices.
The average Black American in the city of Boston has $8 in their bank account. And the average in the city of Boston for a white American has over $200,000 not in a bank account, but throughout different accounts through inherited wealth or from retirement, etc. That is a disparity that you can't look away from. But what that plays out to is that it also goes and creates situations where land use creates, in climate change, where people live, how water is used, how sewers are created. All of those things are tied together, the public services. So when developers come into a city, and you think about populations of density, you should be very concerned about how schools are placed. You should be very concerned about what is left to be open space and what is not. I'd say the third, probably that's most pressing, at least for the city of Boston that I see, is air pollution. And it comes from the way that not only very large buildings are built, but whether or not that sort of requirements for residential buildings and the type of materials that are being used. Because certain communities, such as Mattapan, Dorchester, parts of Dorchester and Roxbury, we have the highest rates of asthma. The average lifespan for somebody in Roxbury, for a black American person, is 56 years old. That's their average lifespan. The average lifespan for somebody in Back Bay is 96 years old. That's today. So, which is absurd to say, but that's what we come to.
Boston has a long history of racial discrimination relating to property ownership and leasing. The first racially restrictive covenant in the country was established by Boston in 1843, and the city doubled down with a similar law in 1927. The process of redlining began in the 1930s with the establishment of the House Ownership Loan Corporation. This organization would redline certain areas they considered undesirable. This would cause these locations to be denied capital investments, which if granted could improve the housing and economic opportunities for residents. Redlined areas were frequently home to communities of color. Gentrification has heavily impacted Boston as well, really meaning the process in which a lower-class urban area is changed by the incorporation of wealthier amenities and businesses attracting higher-class inhabitants and displacing the previous tenants. This process is prevalent in cities, especially as they expand and attract national or international attention. Boston is no exception into this process. A 2020 study by the National Community Reinvestment Coalition rated Boston as the third most gentrified city in the United States in the last decade. Climate change, redlining, gentrification, and other capitalist systems continue to make life hard in black and brown communities in Boston. These neighborhoods have also suffered from a loss of natural space.
Trees are not evenly distributed in urban areas, and that goes back to a long history around some racist policies like redlining, to disinvestment, to just the way the city was built over the past centuries, where some communities have a lot more tree canopy coverage than others, which leads to inequitable distribution of not only trees, but all their important benefits, like cooling city streets, absorbing air pollution, reducing noise, cutting down on heating and cooling costs, making people just happy and feel better, health benefits, mitigation against flooding.
You're supposed to have the right to clean air, clean water, and clean dirt, right? So if you don't have all three of those, it becomes a public health issue. Your public health issues are human rights issues, right? So it reaches into everything from food insecurity. It will touch you on whether or not you're able to build something in a certain area. It affects all of us in such a way that, you know, whoever knew that we would end up having to fund what are called Superfund sites and spend, you know, $1 billion+ cleaning things that if we had heeded warnings, we would not have been in the situation to which we're in now.
These issues have inspired a desire for environmental justice. Small steps have been taken to improve the effects on communities and wild spaces, but many steps remain. Rewilding is the process of bringing back nature into urban settings, which helps promote connections and healthier ecosystems.
You're really thinking about the whole ecosystem and how it functions with all the plants and animals together, and including us. Humans are animals, just another animal in an ecosystem.
Nature really should be used as a service provider in cities because of all these benefits that we know about. If we can restore nature in the city, we can do it anywhere. It's kind of like a challenge in a way.
Many organizations in Boston are working towards rewilding with the common goal of bringing nature back into urban areas. The Boston Urban Wilds Program is a division of the Parks and Recreation Department and is responsible for maintaining the 29 urban wilds throughout Boston's neighborhoods.
So what I do in my job is oversee field operations for the Urban Wilds Program. So we have all sorts of field work going on, mostly year-round. We have a lot of volunteer work where we work with local neighborhood groups or even corporate groups that come and help us out to clean up our properties, remove invasive species, and help add on to our ecological restoration projects.
Another organization promoting rewilding is Speak for the Trees Boston. They work to connect everyone through approachable information on trees, as well as growing and protecting Boston's tree canopy. Their work encompasses environmental justice, racial and social equity, public health, and climate change.
We work with the City of Boston, the Parks and Recs Department. We partner with some national organizations, including the Arbor Day Foundation and American Forests. And then we partner with community groups throughout the city. And there are a lot of them that we work with. Edgewater Neighborhood Association, Mattapan Food and Fitness, Eastie, Friends of Melnea Cast Boulevard. We have a lot of nonprofits, some of them with a staff and some of them just volunteer.
Boston Urban Forest Friends is a coalition of organizations, community groups, and individuals focused on increasing partnerships and collaboration around growing Boston's urban canopy. All of these organizations collaborate to keep and create green spaces for everyone's use. Their work in transforming urban spaces can have tremendous benefits for the city of Boston.
Little abandoned parcels of land. Put in a community garden or a food forest in every other block around the city. That actually would provide both ecological values, right? They become spaces for the birds and the bees and our migrating species and things like that. But they would also provide spaces of connection for our communities.
Cities are a huge contributor to carbon emissions, creating a majority of greenhouse gases released into the air. They are heavily populated and are responsible for holding up economies and government systems. Rewilding in urban areas is tricky because of the lack of open space and appropriate funding. This forces an opportunity to get creative when adding more urban green space. Rewilding in a city looks drastically different than rewilding in a small rural town. While creating new green spaces like parks and walkways is necessary, reworking current underdeveloped plots is often more attainable of a solution. As temperatures rise all over the world, cities are experiencing the worst effects with urban heat islands. A need for parks and tree canopy is rising higher on the lists of lawmakers in large U.S. cities.
Early through the entire 20th century redlining activities, and so what we have here in Boston, as a consequence of that,
there are consequences if we don't start seeing ourselves as integrally tied to the natural world. Again, this whole rewilding, urban rewilding, is so wonderful. It's just looking at particularly native host plants.
While a properly green city is essential for long-term public health and to mitigate the effects of climate change, rewilding is not profitable for larger corporations. Capitalism does not prioritize sustainability. Capitalism prioritizes, instead, profits. It is much more economically enticing to convert unused land for profit rather than leaving it wild. This conflict lies at the center of the Crane Ledge Woods development controversy. At the intersection of the Boston neighborhoods of Hyde Park, Rosendale, and Mattapan lies a 24-acre stretch of land called Crane Ledge Woods. With a 43% canopy cover, the woodland absorbs heat and sound, and it provides a refuge to members of these communities. It also reduces concrete coverage and cools down neighborhoods, shielding residents from the extreme sun and heat. Each acre of forest absorbs harmful pollutants, including particulates, ozone, nitrogen dioxide, and sulfur dioxide, providing health benefits such as reduced asthma. The woodland provides a sanctuary for wildlife and a tranquil place for people to exercise and relieve stress. Crane Ledge Woods and surrounding urban wilds have been a benefit to Boston for generations. Furthermore, the forest helps prevent flooding in surrounding neighborhoods by allowing rainwater to be soaked up by the roots and soil.
I think that the Crane's Ledge Wood Project is a really good example of the importance of thinking about green space and justice. Yes. And housing at the same time. That particular parcel of land sits in a neighborhood that has lower tree cover than many of the other places in the city. And so that parcel of land is extremely important for mitigating the urban heat island and extremely important for just having a place that's not pavement.
Crane Ledge Woods is owned by the Jubilee Christian Church. Lincoln Property Company wants to invest $100 million to develop 14 acres of Crane Ledge Woods into 270 residential units, including 41 affordable housing units, which they say will help fight Boston's current housing crisis. This project would create 300 construction jobs, 15 permanent ones, and an estimated $900,000 in annual tax revenue for the city, along with a significant financial boost for the Jubilee Christian Church. Housing is an undisputed issue in Boston which needs a solution. Because most of the proposed units are market rate, the issue of affordable housing could possibly be exacerbated by the gentrification that would come, hence the installation of the new units.
People in the community came together to say, uh-oh, what are we going to do? We can't purchase this land, but we need to stop this development. Mm-hmm. So a lot of different neighborhood activists got together to try to build a coalition to push back against the development of the land.
There was pushback from local residents and advocates, but also from the Boston Planning and Development Agency. After reviewing a draft project impact report submitted by the developer, the BPDA said this project will increase stormwater runoff and the rising temperature in the city. Opponents also take issue with the developer's report of Crane Ledge Woods as a damaged and desolate site and fear the massive negative environmental impacts this construction project would bring. Destroying Crane Ledge Woods could result in flooding, urban heating, and the loss of a beautiful refuge for Boston residents. The church says they don't plan on backing out of the deal with the Lincoln developers. Even though the community has appealed to the city to buy the land from the church, no action has been made to that end. Lincoln said that the city buying the church land would be a poor use of public funds and a great deal of work to maintain. Crane Ledge is the largest unprotected urban wild in Boston, and it deserves a form of sanctuary. It is important to recognize that the plan to replace the forestry of Crane Ledge with apartments is not being done out of hope to take action on implementing more affordable housing. The proposed infrastructure will not work to resolve the current problems Boston faces with its lack of affordable housing, but instead will cater to the wealthier, whiter communities with these new and improved living spaces.
The idea that someone would come in and think that part of what we should be doing to mitigate the housing shortage is by developing open space that is natural and turning it into asphalt into buildings, to me seemed to be an oxymoron, right? How do we want to continue to have good health for the future and good health for ourselves if in fact we were going to cause more harm than good?
Organizations such as Speak for the Trees and the Boston Climate Action Network are taking action towards preventing the renovation of Crane Ledge Woods. Community members have also created their own organization, the Crane Ledge Woods Coalition, to conserve and restore the forest. This is still an ongoing debate with ramifications in the larger rewilding and environmental justice efforts. Activists hope that saving Crane Ledge Woods will inspire more community involvement.
I think you'll see a lot of people coming together when, I'd like to think when it's preserved, to continue to care for it and steward it. I think it will activate that space, and I think it will encourage people, and it will demonstrate that local communities should be further empowered to care for their environment and their opportunities to do that, not only in preservation, but in taking active roles in pressuring the city and advocating for things, and also in expanding canopy in other ways.
This is just one example of the ongoing struggle in Boston to protect existing green space from developers. In the future, activists hope that other communities will work together to conserve their green spaces, while also working within the city council and the legislature to make bigger changes in the city. Rewilding happens through both community activism and legislative changes. For centuries, Boston has struggled to provide its underserved communities with necessary green spaces. Tree canopy is drastically lower in predominantly black and brown neighborhoods, causing higher levels of air pollution and greater impact from climate change-induced disasters like flooding and heat waves. Affordable housing is also at the forefront of Boston's social inequities. While wealthier neighborhoods have better desirability because of green spaces and tree-lined streets, low-income neighborhoods lack these benefits. While the state or outside investors create a beautiful recreational space, nearby housing becomes less affordable, and the original park users get pushed out. This is an issue that many community activists in Boston are currently working on. Additionally, there's still a need for volunteers and more community action to protect the green spaces in low-income neighborhoods from wealthy developers. The lack of urban wild spaces won't get solved tomorrow, but incremental change is possible.
We just need to take small steps as a community, as individuals, as an organization, and enough small steps will get us there, but there are no big steps we can take.
Youth and community involvement are also key to making change.
So we really just teach the youth about ways to protect the greenlands spaces, how it's important to their community, and ways that, things that we hope that they'll be able to take with them as they get older and choose careers in life and be a part of communities.
While education has been the traditional avenue of communication to voice the concerns of climate change, it is not enough on its own. As the world evolves and the need for climate environmentalists and activists grow, secondary and higher education is less significant than actual action.
Well, for a lot of green jobs, there needs to be more ease of entry. Maybe there doesn't need to be a bachelor's or master's degree required for some jobs, and it's just like a thing of the past. Somebody who's been, you know, doing their own nature work in their own life on their own property or what have you doesn't necessarily need college training to know what a plant is or how to identify things or how to fix issues.
Part of increasing access to green jobs is getting youth involved in community action projects from the beginning. The Green Team Initiative, for example, provides youth in the community with opportunities to participate in the restoration and management of the Sharon Woods Urban Wild while teaching them valuable climate action skills. This is an opportunity to kickstart the entry of Gen Z into the environmental workforce. Another way to make change is through the legislature. Neighborhood planning committees often have community action projects that citizens can get involved in.
Yeah, I do think that sometimes you might need to actually go to a planning board meeting or meet with people in town government to make a plea for different regulations and advocate for more of nature in your cities and towns.
People can take independent action as well by introducing aspects of nature into where they spend most of their time at or around their city homes. As more of the world's population shifts into cities, we have a real call to action to conserve our urban wilds. Not only does urban rewilding provide environmental benefits, it also improves quality of life. Unfortunately, underserved areas within cities, including Boston, are often the first to see the decrease in wild and green areas. Crane Ledge Woods and other urban wilds are important areas to conserve. While it is important to make and maintain beautiful parks for recreation, diversifying wild areas is beautification in its own way.
When I think about how to manage spaces, especially in urban areas, I think that there's a lot of value in diversity. The places that I love the best are the places that are the least managed.
I think a lot of the natural areas need more care and attention, and if we can loop more community folks and get more staff to help support that, that would be amazing. And I think that that's really important for the long-term trajectory of this work, particularly in the city of Boston. I know lots of other cities are putting a lot more attention into their natural areas, like New York City has.
We need to deal with more, creating more livable, walkable cities. And I think that somehow there are things that can happen in these communities that may have less resources. There still are strong, strong advocates for nature. And yeah, it's communities have power if they can come together and really ask for more livable areas in cities.
One of the many things we can do to help our cities connect with nature is to inform one another and band together. Human connection and relationships can translate into action and power, but there needs to be a mutual understanding of the problem before changes can be made. We, as individuals, have a responsibility to protect the spaces in which we live and respect the surrounding environment that make our living areas possible. As we make an effort towards positive change, it is important to remain in touch with the bigger picture and acknowledge questions as they come up.
I think it's incumbent on all of us to understand historically, first and foremost, we're standing on sacred ground. You know, the Massachusetts tribe, this was their home for centuries before, you know, Europeans and others came here to colonize and to develop and then just basically do what we have done over years of time, right? And so, A, we should pay attention to the fact, what was the relationship between the indigenous people of North America and nature and the ecosystem writ large? And what were they thinking about moving forward? You know, they have a philosophy of seven generations where everything that they thought of, every decision that they made in the context of how would that impact seven generations later. We have to take that same model. The fight that we're engaged in is one of not just for us, not just for us, it's for those seven generations in the future, so that therefore our children's children's children will have a healthy existence and possibly live a life in which they will not have to worry about heat, they will not have to worry about asthma, will not have to worry about flooding, will not have to worry about all those things. On the contrary, where they can thrive because we have done the right thing as the leaders and as community members and stakeholders in this community. So this is one way for us to mitigate it. It's a small part of a bigger picture, but it's a very important part of that bigger picture. And we have to understand that we're just part of that worldwide picture that has to do with the climate and the changes that are going through at this very moment. So we're hoping that our effort will motivate others to engage in a worldwide climate change movement, and in particular in their respective neighborhoods.
For a city to thrive, a balance must be struck between nature and the modern technology that has created this absence of natural space in the first place. Around the world, many cities are prioritizing rewilding as a solution. Amsterdam's Resilio project installs smart roofs that absorb rainwater to grow vegetation and reduce the heat island effect. Liverpool, England, turned the concrete exterior of St. John's Shopping Center into a planting space for over 14,000 evergreens and, more recently, several beehives. The city of Curitiba in northwestern Brazil planted over 139,000 trees between 2013 and 2016 alone, and now boasts more than 1,000 green oases. Madrid, Spain, has one tree for every 20 inhabitants, which makes up about 300,000 trees across the city. And this is just the beginning. As temperatures rise and natural disasters become regular events, cities struggle with the effects of climate change on their citizens and resources. Rewilding helps to prevent urban heat islands, and added green spaces act as flood barriers for neighborhoods. The redesign of old buildings to newer energy-efficient ones will also aid the overall global effect of greenhouse gases. Each day that we stand by, allowing the brutalism of concrete infrastructure to take over, we lose a point of contact with our natural world. There is one way that this can be restored, and that is if we focus our attention and come together to create and protect our urban wilds.
We co-evolved with plants and animals on this planet in our ecosystems. We find things that are reminiscent of nature to be beauty. Our beauty is completely
based on healthy natural systems, forms, just thinking about how we function as animals in the world, that we find beauty as very harmonious with nature.
My ultimate goal is a city that is green as heck, like super green. Every nook and cranny has plants in it that is helping the city to thrive and connecting people to nature. And I grapple with this a little bit because maybe talking about using nature as a tool isn't exactly the right approach.
Let me tell you, I am so inspired by your generation. I don't think you can possibly understand how folks like me have been waiting for you our entire lives.
It takes diligence, it takes commitment, and it takes honesty. So long as you're willing to do the work, it can be done. You have one lifetime. Don't waste it.